We have two artists up here and two scholars, though I don't think we can put any of them in only those buckets. And so I'd love it if you guys could each talk about how you transmit the memory in your own lives, your own work, and what the most important aspects of that are. So starting with Guila, who's a UNESCO Artist for Peace and also the artistic director of tonight's performance.
So I've been a PhD student of Professor Elie Wiesel. I've been working with him during 5 years on his theater plays. When I wrote him back in 2003, I read a fantastic play he wrote that was called The Trial of God. He was putting God into a trial, dealing with this idea of the Shoah. And I was very lucky because I discovered, thanks to him, that he wrote all the plays that were not published, but that were considered by his publisher maybe of smaller importance compared to the novels. He's more known as a novelist, of course. And my goal working with him along those years was not to make him a playwright. It was more to try to understand how a survivor could use theatrical techniques, could use the stage to transmit better. Since then, after my PhD back in 2008 at Boston University, I've been dealing with genocide survivors, Rwanda, Armenia, Bosnia, trying to help them with theater techniques, either to come on stage, express exactly themselves, for two reasons, but we'll discuss about it. First, to transmit to younger generation. Second, to attest that it happened against, you know, genocide deniers. And then I got more and more interested into human rights violation survivors. I've been working a lot with the question of excision, the question of women's rights, up to a point that I received this award, UNESCO Artist for Peace, that allowed me to basically get a better network. I've been fortunate to teach a class at Harvard University Kennedy School, which was called Theater and Human Rights. And then the Political Institute, Sciences Po in Paris, asked me to teach the same class in Paris. So dividing my time between Harvard and Paris. And today is very special for me because I was about to publish my book about Elie Wiesel theater after my PhD. And it was almost done up until Dr. Yoel Rappel, who is the head of the Boston University Elie Wiesel Archive, calls me and tells me, "Are you aware of this play?" And I was not. Elie Wiesel never spoke to me about it. And I opened this play, and it was a real treasure because it was the real core. It's considered as a primary work, the real core of what Elie Wiesel will develop in many novels in terms of existentialism, in terms of value of death and life and choices that each one of us have to face. And I was mesmerized. So of course, the first phase was asking permission to Elie Wiesel to perform. And I had the great chance to meet Professor Kevin Madigan from Harvard Divinity School, with whom I spoke, who told me his admiration for Elie Wiesel and who allowed me to become a fellow at the Harvard Divinity School and to present this project today. So thank you again, Professor Madigan, and thank you again to you for being here.
So before we move on, though, I want to ask, what, in terms of what you're doing, how do you see it as transmitting memory, and what do you think is the importance of transmitting memory? And then I guess I'd ask, how everybody here can transmit memory, if you could speak to that a little bit before we...
Yes, of course, and I'm going to be brief because I really want you to listen to the wonderful panelists who are here. My goal is not to make the Shoah artistic. My goal is not to use ashes to have a new growing flowers, you know, as Baudelaire used to do, flowers of evil. I'm trying, on the contrary, to use art, to use pantomimes techniques, to use theatrical ideas to transmit the Holocaust. Again, to attest that it happened and to transmit to new generation. It has to be within a process that is dealing with media as well, because today, in order to interest young generations, you need to be aware of this mediatic appeal, this thirst they have to be on stage, to be known, to be viewed, to be recognized, to be under the spotlight. And I'm so happy that we are at this level, because a lot of people say, that was better before with the internet connection and with everything going so fast. But I'm actually trying to grasp this thirst of being under the spotlight, being on stage, to trap them and telling them, okay, we're going to do audition. And usually the way I'm doing sites for my auditions is using American Idol colors, so big audition style. And I said, you want to be famous, you want to be on stage, you will be welcome to audition for this new show. And I remember a rapper coming who was all about, you know, the idea of being viewed and being known. And of course, we told him, well, you have been selected, but what you will do and what you will perform actually happened. You will meet someone who went through this experience, traumatic experience. And what happened behind the curtain was almost more important than the day of the show. And I remember what this young man told me. He said, I didn't know it existed. I realized what happened, and I will become a witness of witness. I will pass along the testimony. And for me, of course, it was like a very big, you know, winning the battle, because each one of us can do the difference. And of course, we will discuss also about the importance to do this remembrance duty today, because this is now that everything is happening in terms of age of the survivors, in terms of revival of racism, anti-Semitism all over. I'm coming from France, I'm coming from Europe, so I could tell you, could attest what happened lately in January. This is now that everything is happening. So that's why it's so meaningful to have you.
I'm going to actually start with an anecdotal story that is very current, and then step back to my own personal story. I was on an airplane this past summer going to a scholars conference in genocide studies in Manitoba, Canada, and I sat next to an intelligent, college-educated woman. And you know, when you're on an airplane, if you have a little bit of a rapport, you start a conversation, and we were talking, and of course the woman asked me, where are you going? And I said, well, I'm going to a genocide scholars conference. And the woman looked at me and she said, is that anything like genealogy? And that really sums up my now 15-year odyssey with genocide studies. And I approached genocide, the historical subject, as an artist. I specialize in manuscript illumination, mm-hmm. which is a traditional art form that I've been practicing basically every day since 1985. And I reached a culmination of maturity technically, and I think as an individual, as an adult, where I reached a threshold of a revelation, for lack of a better way to say that, of understanding that I could tackle the subject of genocide and render that with this artistic expression of illuminating the episodes of genocide that have occurred all around the planet. And I was not a historian. I have stumbled my way into some aspect of a historical perspective just through the commitment that I've had over the last 15 years in looking at individual episodes of mass atrocity and treating this experience of research and understanding of the collective history, the collective aspirations, the collective legacy of the victims of mass atrocity. So statistically, according to R.J. Rummel, who's one of our early scholars in the field of genocide studies, approximately 700 million people have been killed via the hand of another human being, whether that's individually or collectively. And the history of genocide scholarship is so nascent in the United States and so needed that sessions like this are critically important for you to understand that genocide is everybody's story. We are never free of this psychological disease until we make a community commitment to educate our children about where these atrocities have happened, what are the social parameters, what are the political parameters, what are the economic parameters that pit and polarize one group against another. And I am doing that artistically. I am taking my personal time and investigating scrupulously who these victims were to give you some bridge of understanding of what it might have been like to live in Iraq in mid-80s and suffer from the Anfal campaigns, or what it might have been like to live in Indonesia in the 60s and be victimized by your neighbor as a result of a political incursion, and really taking an in-depth approach to these locations that have succumbed to what is really our most egregious crime. So I really appreciate being here, and a picture does paint a thousand words, so I can explain in depth what it is that I do, but the best place for you to really see my work is to visit my website online. So I've got all kinds of paraphernalia that we'll share with you later on, but in a nutshell, that's why I'm here.
I am a historian by training. I came here to do my master's and PhD in European history, and my initial emphasis was the history of ideas and intellectual history. But I was over and over drawn to the tremendous impact that the Nazi genocide had on intellectual and cultural life after the war for so many important intellectuals, the way it really was a watershed event in the way that they understood human society. And so I increasingly, in my own research, was interested in the interpretation of the Holocaust. And in terms of teaching, not only teaching the history of Nazi Germany and the Holocaust, but also comparative race relations and historiography, which is to say, not simply teaching the idea of unmediated historical events, but teaching students to understand how it is that historical events are reconstructed and how the people who reconstruct them really make meaning out of them. And to understand that historians really are people too, right? With ethical and historical and biographical locations, and belong to national groups and subgroups, and that we strive to make the past meaningful in really compelling ways. And I think that the Holocaust and other genocides, they've been a trauma on modern society, and they've left profound marks. The impact that lasts from generation to generation, it transforms over time, but it's there in one way or another. You can see it in terms of our own racial legacy in this country, just the way that it continues to reverberate. And I've been involved with a long-term project, which has some particular relevance for this, which is a study of Anne Frank and how she became the victim of the Holocaust, who's most universally known. And I think one of the ideas that emerges from that is the tremendous power of the individual story. It's very hard for people who are coming without the kind of academic background to overcome the sort of unfamiliarity and even ignorance that you're talking about without some way into this history. Most people are not prepared for sociological discussions of modern bureaucracies and the conception of genocide and so on. They can enter into this history through the experience of an individual to whom they can relate. Not that they're the same in every way, but the challenge there is that we want to relate to this history, we need to relate to it, but we also need to understand the ways in which it's dramatically different from our own experience, not to domesticate it, to understand that these really are situations of life and death, of unspeakable suffering and sometimes terrible choices that most of us, thank God, will never have the, never be in a position to have to make such choices. The fascinating thing about the Anne Frank work is that Anne Frank has in every stage of public memory and transformation of the way that people have understood the Holocaust and Nazi criminality and modern anti-Semitism, that Anne Frank has had also a new phase in the way that her story is told. So of course, first the diary came out, but then people began to visit the house in Amsterdam, and it became a museum. And at the same time that that was happening, there was the Broadway play and then the Hollywood film. And then a real initiative of youth education in the 60s and the 70s coming out of Amsterdam, using Anne Frank as a sort of a model for making that history of genocide socially relevant and trying to begin to teach people about ethical choices. I think that more and more education about genocide and the Holocaust has moved from a notion of telling the historical chronology to teaching us how to imagine ourselves in those situations, either as perpetrators or as bystanders or as victims, with all of the moral complexity that's involved with all of those roles. And I was just seeing, you may have seen just in the last 2 weeks, there were two news items about Anne Frank that I'll mention. One of them is that they believe they've now been able to date of her death more accurately than before. And one of the tropes was that she almost lived till the liberation. Almost, that she died maybe late in March. And Bergen-Belsen was liberated not long mm-hmm. after that. But in fact, it seems that she died probably in the first half of February. In the big scheme of things, it's a small difference. But this was actually a research finding which was based on assembling all of the testimony from Bergen-Belsen at the time in a way which had never been done before, including the addition of a single new interview of a woman who knew Anne and her sister in the camp. And there were other interviews in the past. And so it's kind of amazing that the most studied victim of the Holocaust, you could actually find someone new to interview who was there at the time that she was deathly ill, whose testimony has never been checked against the other testimonies. Mm-hmm. And the other story was that the question of who actually identified the Franks as hidden Jews to the Nazis and to the German and to the Dutch collaborators, to the Green Police, the Gestapo. It's a question that's never been answered definitively. But one of the women who worked in Otto Frank's business, both of the women who worked there were involved in hiding and helping the Franks, but one of them who has a sister who has now been identified by family members as being a Nazi collaborator for 4 years during the period that the Franks were in hiding. And actually her son and the journalist with whom he worked on this memoir says we have arrived at the conclusion that she is quite possibly the person who is responsible for betraying the Franks and the other hidden Jews. And of course, 7 of the 8 of them died as a result of this betrayal and their subsequent arrest and deportation to concentration camps. And I think what's important about that is that in the early history of Anne Frank's popularity, the notion that the Dutch resisted, that there were these Nazi perpetrators out there, all the Dutch were good resistors and protected the Jews, that now people understand that no, it's quite a bit more complicated than that. Mm. That bystanders were not all resistors. Many were trying to stay out of it, and others were participating in a much more negative way. And that this is the kind of a complexity in terms of our understanding, not just of what Dutch civilians did at that time, but what it really is like for people to live through a historical period like this, and what are the consequences of the choices that they make. So these stories get told over and over again in ways which maintain their relevance. And I think it's remarkable that you're bringing a play tonight for a reading, mm-hmm. which is really about moral choices. It's not a new play, but I think for many of us, it will be a new story by a very well-known author presenting this issue of moral choices yet again in a new way for us to think about. So I'm looking forward to it.
Thank you.
Well, let me just begin by saying it's so interesting to hear about the Anne Frank story, because I grew up going to parochial school and went through a Catholic school. Right through high school, and we often hear in our culture and society jokes about nuns and so forth, but it was actually nuns who introduced me to the story of Anne Frank and planted a seed, I think, way back in the sixth grade. I did my PhD in the history of Christianity with not much focus on the Holocaust, and about 5 years into my career, I was given a chance, which I leapt at, to study with Raoul Hilberg, the now late Raoul Hilberg, who was at that time the doyen of Holocaust studies in the United States. And then the following summer was given another chance to study at Northwestern University with Peter Hayes and with other historians of the Holocaust, which I also took. And from that point on, that became part of my curriculum, that is course offerings, and a large part of my scholarly interest and so forth. So I'm actually beginning right now, I'll be going to Rome next year to begin a book on the Italian Holocaust, which is, of course, part of the Nazi Holocaust, but is not as well known or studied. In any case, as Rachel suggests, in my 15 years here or so at Harvard, I've taught every other year, a freshman seminar. We have a very robust series of freshman seminars. I teach one on the Holocaust called The Holocaust in History, Literature, and Film. And then in the Divinity School, and I see my colleague Anne Brode out here. It's great to have her here. In the Divinity School, I teach a course called The Holocaust in the Churches. And as that title suggests, that one is focused much, much more directly on particularly the complicity and collaboration of the churches, a little bit on the resistance of the churches, as well as on ethical issues, on what religious leadership should do or what religious leaders historically did or did not do during that time period. I do want to address directly Rachel's question. When I, on memory and how I try and cultivate that provide a forum for it to be passed on and cultivated. When I, when any professor at Harvard teaches a freshman seminar, he or she in the fall receives applications. In other words, we'd like to keep our enrollment around 15, and you often get 20 or 25 or 40 applications. And I want to tell you the story of the very, very first time I taught this, which was around 2004 to freshmen, and got applications. And the very first application that I opened began, "I am the son of four Holocaust survivors." So all four of his grandparents were Holocaust survivors. In any case, this was a time, and we'll remember it, well, and you may as well. It was not a great time because, in the sense that our assignments for a class were due after Christmas, which gave the students no break, but it gave them plenty of time to complete any project that they had in mind. In this case, this young man who has since graduated from Harvard Medical School and done his residency, I think, at one of the downtown hospitals, traveled to Poland, traveled to Yad Vashem, and came back with a 120-page paper. I asked for a 20-page paper. This was a good example of overachievement in Harvard College. But in any case, he did 30 pages on each of his grandparents. He looked at the social backgrounds of each of his parents and examined the little shtetl in which each of his grandparents grew up, and told the story of all four. And since then, he's continued to add to it. And so this has become a family treasure. Mm. So that's one example. And in the 14 or 15 years, I also teach this course in the summer schools almost every year. In, I would say, most of these classes, I have either many or a majority of students who had grandparents who were survivors or who died during the war. And I give them a great deal of latitude on their final project, but I do encourage them to integrate whatever sort of personal experience they have, personal memories, personal documents at home. I think of one young woman whose grandfather escaped to Shanghai, actually 20,000 Jews, of all places, escaped to Shanghai, who did a project with all the documents that got her grandfather to Shanghai. In any case, I asked them to integrate the scholarly materials, insofar as they can, that we deal with in the course, with their own personal stories, their familial stories, often their grandparents' stories, and to just go where they will with that, whether it be a documentary film. Many interviews on film have been created this way. Lots of personal documentary stories, other kinds of artistic stories, dramas, fictions, and so forth, or fictions based on their parents' stories, and so on and so forth. So that would be the most direct answer. I would also say that I'm really interested in the role that, as I said, that religious leadership plays in, or did play in the Holocaust. And a lot of my scholarship really is concentrated on what sort of role the Vatican did or did not, I would say mostly did not play, despite insofar as any government was, in Western government was informed, the Vatican was probably the most well-informed government in the West, and that would include, I think, London and Washington. And so one of the questions I ask, which is essentially, I think, both an ethical and an historical question, is why did the Vatican, which was fully and well-informed about this issue, not do more? So I've written a good deal on that as well. I think I'll pause there. So.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. So a few of you have mentioned personal histories and family stories and how important that is. And Alex, you said, I think really eloquently, that we enter history through the individual. So I think that's a great segue to introduce Janet, survivor of the Holocaust, Janet Applefield. And I think if you could speak to, before you tell your story, to kind of how you transmit memory of the Holocaust through your story and through the work that you do. What do you find most effective? What gets through to people today, and what are the difficulties in that?
So I'm one of those very lucky children that survived. I was just 4 years old when the war began. 1.5 million Jewish children were murdered. Only 11% survived. And I've been speaking to students, middle school and high school, and other populations about my experiences. I tell them my story, and I try to expand the context to include all types of prejudice and discrimination and violence and other genocides. I know that when I'm no longer here, I know that my story, my legacy will continue, because my children and grandchildren will continue to tell my story. But when I speak to the students, I ask them for a very special favor. I ask them, how many of you think that you could tell my story to others that haven't heard me? And most everybody raise their hands, and I thank them for that, because that's such a special gift. Because I tell them that I am a witness of history, and because they've heard my story, they are witnesses. And I also talk about choices and decisions that we all make. And I speak about the people that saved me and helped me. And there were quite a few people that stepped up and saved me. And they didn't just save me, they saved me and my children, my grandchildren, and future generations. And so I speak to the students about the decisions and the choices that they make, because even the smallest act of kindness has a ripple effect. And I also speak about upstanders and bystanders, and because after all, the people that helped me didn't have to do that. They could have just turned their backs and said, it's too hard, it's too dangerous, it's none of my business, I don't want to get involved. But they didn't. So I encourage the students to think about the choices and decisions that they make throughout their lives. And about 3 years ago, I was contacted by a Polish woman, a young historian, who lived in my town. And she became interested in what happened to the Jewish population during occupation. And then she did extensive research, and she found my family's name, and she contacted me. And as a result, she is a PhD candidate. She matriculates at University of Warsaw. And she has used my family as a case study for her research. So she's done a tremendous amount of research about my family. And she found exactly what happened to my mother, because all these years I didn't know exactly how she died. But she found a court document that there was a man who knew the family, and he swore under oath that he recognized my mother's body. So now I know that my mother was shot and killed in Płaszów, and that happened in August of 1943, because this man's job was to pick up the bodies after people were killed. And she's done other research about other family members. You know, she found out how my grandfather died. He tried to escape to Krakow, but someone recognized him, reported him to the Gestapo, and he was tortured. They attached him to a horse-drawn cart, and they dragged him for miles, and of course he died. And I know what happened to my other family members, what camps they were deported to, and I'm fortunate because I reach thousands and thousands of students every year. Like this year, I think I have like 38 speaking engagements. Yeah. So I'm pretty busy right now, because it usually occurs in March, April, and May. Those are the 3 months that I'm so busy. I feel that I am contributing to the preservation of memory. And I get amazing feedback from students and teachers, and I even talk about obviously I tell my story, but many kids make connection to their own stories, because we all have stories. And some kids have come up and said, you know, you've taught me to be braver, now I think I can go on and face my issues and my problems. So I feel that my talk is helpful on many different levels.
How do you guys receive stories? I think you are all prolific in sharing with others stories and making sure that transmission is happening. But then what have you found have been most effective to you? And what stories have impacted you the most, and then how did you move forward from there?
You know, as a visual artist that specializes in a very quiet, contemplative craft, the process of understanding the story of a group starts with looking at the location and finding out when that period of history would have encountered this dramatic upheaval of violence. And in the case of a modern atrocity, I will seek out individuals or groups that may have borne witness or experienced that episode of atrocity to further enlighten my historiographical approach to a collective knowledge, a collective understanding, a collective narrative, and the goal being to meld individual stories into a collective entity. Because in my understanding of incorporating the concept of genocide, like you said, physically, you know, what does it mean to have be a victim? What does it mean to, in a place that I might have no connection to whatsoever, whether it's language or visiting or really any understanding, and how do I make that connection between something that's so foreign and so strange into myself so that it's a real story, that it's a genuine, authentic connection? And that's a hypothetical approach, but it is this attempt to create some historical perspective so that you, as the viewer, can identify this understanding of a group. What is the story of the group? And there is a trajectory between an individual story and hundreds of stories, thousands of stories, millions of stories of a particular group. So that is, my goal as an artist, and as an individual making that journey and then reproducing it visually for you to explore yourself, hopefully, just like, Dorothy walking the Yellow Brick Road, you take your first step into that perspective yourself, so that, I'm sort of paving the way.
I will maybe just add something that, thanks to you, I'm getting a clear idea, also putting the proper words and the proper words in English into my reflection. I think that this workshop that we wanted to do as Remembrance Ambassadors had, as I said, three moments. One was really, and this is the one that we are living, the scholar moments, that were really talking to intellect and talking to mind. The second will be more focusing on personal history. So here, talking to heart, and we are going to get into the individual path that, I'm the same. And the last would be the body, would be more the guts about, okay, so what shall I do now? What are my choice? I could feel the transition that you said, basically, how do I make this personal, individual testimony into something symbolic, into something that could be understood today, into something collective? And it's really also by just realizing that we all have the power of carrying humanity, really, physically, mentally, psychologically. And sometimes I'm asking my performers, when they have to embody the role, because sometimes I'm doing it through fiction, sometimes I'm having the chance to have a survivor who will be on stage and who will testify, but sometimes I'm having survivors asking me to perform their life. And then you have actors who have to embody, to really feel and have the transmission of the story. So I ask my actors sometimes to pinch themselves, but very, very strong. And they're like, ay, hurts. And I said, the first thing you have to admit, being an actor who has to be devoted to this type of cause, meaning genocide, is that it is impossible to do actor studio technique. You will have to have the humility to admit that no matter what, you will never in your life experiment this pain. You will never in your life experiment this loss, and you will never get to a level where you could try to mimic or try to imitate what you think could be the sadness, the suffering of those people. Once you get to this point of humility as an actor, which is extremely hard, because when you are an actor, you're raised to mimic, to imitate, to grasp from real life and get into imitation again and again with very hard masterization of your body, very hard discipline, trying to show the other that you are someone else. When you're addressing those genocide matters, you have to admit that you are not this someone else. You will never be this someone else. Your body will be used to have their voice listened. And it's really very different as being an actor, because you will not embody a character. you will have to take a distance within your own body, within your own voice, for people to understand that your voice is having another voice coming out to listen to this transmission. And so the relationship with the body is also something extremely different. And I thank you very much for really putting the proper words into this passage of the personal to the collective, to the image, to the symbol, because this is what we as artists are creating, symbol, for people to suddenly realize that, oh, this image means something in intemporal, atemporal. I think that's how you say it. So this be the way I would answer your question.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So first I wanted just to comment on something that you said that I thought was very interesting and really wanted just to underline it, which is that you said, talking about telling the story, it's not just the story of an individual that one can relate to. It's also telling the story of a group. Mm-hmm. So we're talking about victim groups, mm-hmm, that have collective identities. Mm-hmm. And that...
sometimes very ancient ones.
Sometimes very ancient ones, and sometimes ones that are not ours. Mm-hmm. And I think it's very important. One of the most rewarding things that I've done is participate in continuing education seminars for high school and middle school teachers who are teaching the Holocaust, sometimes because it's in the state standards, but it's not their expertise, right. It's not their background, and it's a tremendous burden for them to have to teach a subject that has so much weight and so much complexity and also sometimes so much sensitivity and controversy. So teachers can very innocently wind up in a classroom where someone brings up Holocaust denial and they don't have the training to respond to this. It can be all sorts of things that happen. And as you know from your work in comparative genocide, in all cases, mm-hmm, there are counter narratives, mm-hmm, and there are narratives of denial, people, right, who deny guilt and people who deny complicity, mm-hmm, in all of these, and people who minimize and who implicate victims as, you know, as bringing this on themselves. These structures repeat over and over again with Armenians and other places. And I think one of the questions that you've brought to mind here is that there are less and less survivors to tell their story. And so there's been a lot of discussion about what that means. And I think one of the things that's important to realize is that in the years immediately following World War II, people didn't talk about the Holocaust very much. It was the moment at which there were more survivors than at any other moment. Mm-hmm. Right? There was, subsequent to that, a kind of a cultural transformation that survivors became more and more ready and more committed to telling their story. They figured out more and more effective ways of doing it. But this broader society, both in Europe and internationally, became more and more open and became more and more interested. And so I think we have lots of testimony. We have original diaries from the time, which is what historians prefer. We have testimonies from now, oral testimonies and so on, that survivors have done. Mm-hmm. And the transformation of technology has made all of this massively accessible. Mm-hmm. So the Spielberg Archive and the Yad Vashem Archive and the resources of the Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington are now available to anybody on their smartphone that gets on the guest Wi-Fi here. And you can see streaming, you can get close. It's incommensurable. You won't be inside the experience, it won't be more your experience, but you can get close to it in a way which is powerful and really meaningful. And I think one of the things that I would say is that not everybody makes the professional choices to become an expert, a professional academic expert in this. Mm-hmm. But these are the kind of things that everyone needs to care about. And yes, we all want to make the decision to become more and more educated about it, but we also have to not be absolutely overwhelmed by how much there is to know. And we have to understand that there is a role for the choice to be passionate. It's a choice to be passionate about this. I I am passionate about what happened in the history of the United States, not only slavery, but also with Native Americans, deportation, and you know, and mass death, and so on. These are not my areas of scholarly expertise, but I care about them. They have moral weight. And so I think this is something that we all can do to choose that, to say to ourselves, this is something that I care about. I want to know enough about this, and I have to be willing to talk about it. Whether it's to share a link on your Facebook page or to retell a story that you heard from a survivor, just to make this part of the way that you live in the world. Mm-hmm. It won't be your personal experience, but it will be part of what you share, of what's worth knowing and what's worth having in mind.
Do they not want you to retell their story?
Not usually.
Well, in that case, I think you have to respect that. Yeah. But there are survivors, I would assume, that would want their story to be told and retold. They want the story to be known. And if that's the case, you know, I think it would be good to retell it. There is a new program that was started by the Holocaust Center of the North Shore. It's called the Legacy Project. And certain people have volunteered to tell the stories of the survivor. And they're trained in how to do this. They don't want the person to talk about history because they're not historians and it's not about history. So there's a certain way of telling that story. And they go around, they tell that story when the survivor is either no longer here or is not able to tell their own story.
Any other questions?
I think Kevin was about to mention something.
Yeah, back to your question, Rachel, about how we receive the stories. As historians, we often receive the stories at a sort of macro scale or a macro level, you know, with numbers, with zero, zero, zeros after them. And so I think one of our challenges, or certainly one of the challenges I've faced, is how to downsize that story so mm-hmm. that it's graspable and understandable by an individual. I think what Janet is doing is just so commendable, and Janet, I just thank you for being here. That's one way I do it in my own class. So one year I brought in a woman who had been saved by Oscar Schindler, actually. And she actually did give permission for her story to be repeated. And that was a remarkable, remarkable class, as you might imagine. Mm-hmm. Two other ways. I actually happen to have a master's degree in English Lit as well, although my failed literary critic, I would say. there's lots of incredible literature out there that downsizes the story, and also lots of good film out there that downsizes mm-hmm. the
and
story.
Art.
And art, yes. And I think insofar as you can integrate those into history courses, you should. One other thing I would want to say is that particularly for somebody like me, right, whose ancestors were not potentially victims of the Holocaust, it's good for us to remember what category we might, or imagine what category we might have fallen into. I'm an Irish Catholic, so I very likely would not have been, a direct participant or perpetrator, but it's probably likely that I would have been a bystander, and it's good to remember that. And to I forget who it was who said the three lessons of the Holocaust are: don't be a victim, don't be a perpetrator, and don't be a bystander. In some way, I think that third one is for us one of the most important to remember. And finally, I would just say that one book I always use in my courses to sort of bring home the reality that it wasn't just ideological go-getters or, you know, bloodthirsty SS men who did the killing was Christopher Browning's classic Ordinary Men, which some of you may have read. Yeah. This is a book about middle-aged men who were not, who came to political maturity after Hitler came to power and so forth, and yet, though they initially resisted participating, they eventually did participate in the shooting and other, you know, deportations and so forth. Brown used the Milgram experiments and so forth. And what essentially the point of the book is that any of us goyim are capable, I think, of atrocities like this. And I think this is something that we all have to be aware of as well.
Yes. Is it appropriate to say anything?
Yes.
Okay. As one who has grown up under Hitler up to the age of 15, I'd just like to share with you what I do to keep that story alive. Also happen to be a Jewish educator. When I was teaching way, way back in elementary school, Jewish school, and I happened to be the Dharma director, I wrote plays. The first play about the Shoah, about the Holocaust, which was based on my personal experience. And after the children performed it, everybody wanted to know what happened to the second girl. And I couldn't get myself to write it because my best friend did not make it out of Germany. And so I wrote a play where the girl is being hidden by a German family. Many years later, when I retired to Florida, I got a call from a drama school, a high school, the drama department, and somehow they got hold of this play. And they asked me, could they perform it? And of course I said yes. And then they asked me to come and help them pronounce the German words, the Hebrew words. I did that. Would you introduce? I did that. But I felt that it was one way of keep on telling the story. In addition to going to schools and adults, I also collected the stories of the survivors of the synagogue where I lived at the time. And I put it together. And like some of you said, some survivors can't really talk about it openly. So I had them sit next to me and next to the computer, and I wrote a paragraph. I read it back to them, because I wanted it to be their voice and not my voice. But I also sent my personal papers about 2 years ago to Washington, to the Holocaust Museum, because they promised me that I would get a copy of everything, which they did. And I live in a new area in Massachusetts, and I'm doing the same thing as I did before. So I think it's very, very important what you're doing. And yes, there are fewer and fewer of us, and among the few who are remaining, there are also many who really can't speak openly. And so we really have a very important task before us. I just wanted to share that with you.
Thank you very much.
Yes. I just wanted to speak to this question, which is one that I've been really interested in. When I came out of graduate school in religious studies in the early 80s, it was a field dominated by Christians and Christian studies, and I was kind of an oddity as a Jewish graduate in this field. And so I had quite a few invitations to teach Holocaust studies, and I always said no, because for the most part, these were colleges or universities that were trying to initiate Jewish studies, and this was the first thing they could think of. Mm-hmm. And I always felt that was completely inappropriate if there wasn't a Jewish studies curriculum that was established to begin with the Holocaust. So, which is not to say that I oppose the teaching of Holocaust. I'm full of respect and appreciation for everything that our panelists are doing, but I think that those of us who are in surrounding fields have a responsibility to provide the context in which this is not the only thing that people are learning about any of the marginalized groups, because usually if there's genocide, there was already marginalization before that.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're already before the genocide. I mean, it's like with my kids, I'm always asking them, you know, well, what happened before he took your toy? Or, you know, what happened before he hit you and you came running over here? So that's, I think, something that everyone in the academy has to be thinking about is, who are the marginalized groups? Who's not at the table? And how do we bring those voices to the table before there's a genocide, or to look historically at the living cultures then and now? In addition, we can't expect people who are focusing on genocide to be the sole representatives of marginalized cultures.
Definitely. I think your point is extremely good. And I've been working with this Muslim colleague of mine, Dr. Leila El-Bashiri, in Geneva. We have been working in creating a center for interreligious dialogue. Mm. And we are trying to work on educational program in order to kill stereotypes. And no matter which population we are trying to explain the extremism, we are trying to save the entire rationality in order to get out of the emotional level by explaining the context, explaining that doesn't come from nowhere, explaining that the civilization and the culture is not only this. And of course, we are dealing with Islam, we are dealing with Judaism, we are dealing with Christianity, and all of, you know, the obediences. And what you're saying is extremely right concerning not only the contextualization, but also the possibility of expression. Because sometimes some words could just light, you know, a fire in a daily situation, because emotionally we're so involved, mm-hmm. we're so passionate about those debates, that it becomes very quickly a personal question. That is why it's very interesting, because you cannot be interested in those genocide issues if there are no personal involvement. But if there is too much personal involvement, then we became lost again. And then it's a question of passion, of am I right or not? Am I having the truth or not? And this question of truth is also crucial in terms not only about genocide deniers, but also about my right. This is my right to speak on behalf of. And all of these, but you'll see with the exercises that we will do later physically, all of those questions have really to become material that first go through the brain with intellect by recontextualizing things in terms of history, capital H, then being understood with stories of victims in order to be understood how sometimes fanaticism could go completely out of what we would consider being human. And I don't like this idea of those people who killed were inhuman. I don't think so. They were human. We have all the potential of murder, and we all know this. It's very easy to press the proper buttons for us to suddenly find the aggressivity that is, I would say, the animal part of us. Anytime that suddenly became too personal, too private, it touched my family, it touched my ancestors, it touched my ideas. So this, it basically, it unites us in terms of humankind. But it has to be, first of all, rational. That's why we begin with this panel in terms of scholar, to try to put things on the side. This is history. This is what happened. And then we get into, this is what this survivor, this woman, lived in the personal. And then, now, after, we'll try to see physically what it is to be involved, and how can we suddenly try to, you know, feel a certain reaction to be a little more participative in this entire world situation, I would say.
Can I just give a perspective of where the education system is with regards to Holocaust/genocide education programs around this country? We have 11 states, either it's 11 or 12 states, that have mandated education in Holocaust studies. There is no mandated education in genocide studies. There are approximately 30 major atrocities that have occurred around the planet throughout history that are very important historical aspects to understand just as a general citizen. So we don't have that structure set up within our educational community from, you know, from probably 6th, 7th, 8th grade up through college, where somebody can get a basic understanding in genocide or Holocaust education. So that obligation is on all of us, and that is my reason for being here. Is, you know, I went through that trajectory myself where I had no real genuine understanding as an adult of where these atrocities have happened around the world, to, you know, literally being avalanched by the fact of, you know, cracking open a couple of big, giant, you know, statistical books on the statistics of democide and genocide around the world that pretty much every country, every period of history has experienced this kind of mass violence. And the fact that we as a nation have very little grounding in the early history of genocide studies, starting from Raphael Lemkin in 1948, who coined the term. There was not even a definition for mass killing. Never mind the fact that there was no way for us to bring these crimes to justice. There was no judicial apparatus available before World War II, which would bring people to be accountable for crimes of mass scale. So we're really at the very beginning of many of these processes and at the ground level, and you're asking how we can incorporate in our own lives, whether it's creatively or academically or personally, an understanding of genocide history, Holocaust history. It's just take this information upon yourself and realize the pioneers have already done their work. We've got, you know, Samantha Power, Problem from Hell. We've got A Century of Genocide, Israel Charney. There's, you know, the initial scholars have helped us conceptualize and compartmentalize, and like you said, a rational understanding of genocide history. But it does take some work. So the next step is to bring that into your community, bring that into your classroom, talk to your, you know, talk to the high school's supervisors who do the programming, talk to your local colleges, your community colleges, bring guest speakers in, you know, make it your business to understand that genocide education is the primary driving force that's going to bring us past being completely victimized as a global entity by this vicious behavior, which is still ongoing. You know, there are still many parts of the planet that are being victimized. The Sudan is still undergoing atrocities. Sri Lanka still has issues. Central DR Congo still has major violence. And then there are countries that are trying to rebuild their societies from almost complete annihilation. So, you know, there's a lot that we can do on many different levels, but you really do have to take that first step and make the commitment.
Thank you very much to all of our panelists for participating. I think you really kicked us off really wonderfully. Thank you.
Thank you.
We are still alive thanks to people who have helped. This is the good part of human being, and I still believe that good is inside of us.